Welcome to New Hope Church. Great to have you with us today. You are in for a little bit of a surprise, all right? And I'll share it with you in just a few minutes, but we're glad you're here. All right, here's the deal. In the 8 o'clock service, at 8:25, we had a person walk in. And I said, were you coming to the 9:15 service? They said, yes. Okay, so at about 10:15, all right, right in the middle of my sermon, when you see doors, if I point, okay, that means somebody's coming in thinking they're showing up at the 9:15 service, all right? And we will all turn and stare at them. I'm just kidding. They might be guests, all right? We don't want to take them off. But anyway, it always happens, and it's great fun. How many of you got lost on your way to church today? Because of the road changes out there. All right, glad you still found your way. Thanks for being here. Anybody forget to change their clocks last night? You can be, okay, all right, but you're still here. Good, all right, it's great. Glad you're here. Confession's good for the soul. Lousy for the reputation, but it's very, very good for the soul, all right? So thanks for being here. Hey, if you are a guest here today, this is your first time to visit New Hope. We are honored by your presence. We're thrilled that you would come join us, and we hope that it was worth your effort today. But we would love to know that you were here. We make a promise. We will not bother you at your doorstep. We will not pester you on the phone, but through the mail, we're going to send you some information next week that tells you about the church, what we believe, what our ministries are, various ways you can be engaged, hopefully answer a lot of questions that you might have. And so if you'd be willing to fill out the communication card, it's right there in the pew in front of you. Please do, and drop it in the offering bag when it comes by a little bit later. If you are a regular, you know those cards are there for you to get messages to staff, let us know about prayer requests or updates on existing prayer requests, and so please take advantage of those as well. Hi, Robin. Hey, just quick question. No, that's important. Last night was a great event. It's my second year in a row to be there. It's at the Central Valley Veterans... No, what's the name of that? Central Valley Veterans... Star Spangled Ball. Okay, all right, that was it. It was last night. It's an organization that helps vets, no matter where they are as a veteran, even if they were not honorably discharged. This agency helps them in times of crisis, and what a wonderful group. We had a great evening last night. I got to play auctioneer. Do you know how much we raised during the live auction?
Yes, 35.
35! That's 1,000, right? Yes. Not 100. Okay. And that doesn't count the 17,000 that Carl's Jr. gave. All right, I'm going to start eating at Carl's Jr. more often. I didn't really like them, but they gave $17,000 on top of all that last night. So I'm guessing that your goal of $40,000 with the silent auction and raffles, you must have exceeded. Woo! All right, that is good stuff. That is good stuff. What a great week for us as a nation. Some of you are saying, Tim, it's election week. I know. What a great week for our nation. All right, we get to exercise democracy. We get to exercise what it means to be a republic. And here's what I want to remind you of. Though Tuesday, if you have not already voted by absentee, Tuesday is your day. Go vote. Be in prayer. If you still have some undecided things to determine, be in prayer. Seek the scripture. Seek God's face. See what direction he leads you in, all right? I don't mind you calling me, but I'm not here to tell you who to vote for, all right? And I'm not going to tell you who to vote for president, all right? That one, y'all on your own for that one, okay? I've had a few people call about other things. I don't mind sharing what it is, but that doesn't mean you have to agree with it, all right? But you need to be in prayer, and you need to exercise your responsibility not only as a citizen of the United States, but also a citizen of heaven. We have the right to exercise those privileges that we have been given. We have no idea how many millions and millions of people around the world would like to be involved in the exercise of an election like we are going to participate in on Tuesday. So please, be in prayer and go do that. And here's the deal. God already knows what the outcome is. He already knows that. I promise you, I am not laying awake the next two nights wondering how that thing's going to turn out. Number two, however it turns out, you know what our nation is going to need? Prayer. And I don't care if Abe Lincoln was running again this Tuesday, all right? If he was elected, our nation would be in need of you and I as his people praying. And then, because too many Christians, all we do is pray. And then we need to be engaged. Okay? We need to be engaged in what it means to be a citizen of this incredibly blessed country. So that's enough of that speech. But a lot of veterans' emphasis this week. The event last night, this coming Friday, is the Hubbard Barrow Golf Tournament in honor of Hubbard Barrow, the first two from Buchanan who were killed, and an honor from all those in Clovis. So please be remembering that as we choose not to forget those who've laid down their life for us, and as we also support a good cause, the Veterans Hospital Rehab Program. Over the last, how many years is it now, Mike? 12 years? Yeah, 12 years. We've given in excess of $300,000. And we're hoping to make that in excess of $350,000 by the time this year is over. So that will be on Friday. There's Veterans Day Parade. Our community has been given a wonderful gift that I was unaware of until just a few weeks ago. And Mr. Rios is the new CEO of the Clovis Memorial Veterans District. And what a pistol. All of a sudden, I forgot his first name. Lorenzo Rios. Up until a year ago, he was career military, and at the end of that, he became the CEO of Clovis Memorial District. And let me tell you, he is a veteran who loves Jesus Christ, and that's exciting. And he wants to be engaged in the community and all that's going on. He's gonna, after the parade, he's gonna show up at the Hubbard Barrow event, try to be there for our flag ceremony and devotional thoughts. And I know he's on the run that day for all the activities going on, but he wants to be a part of that. And so we're very excited to have him here. Also on November the 10th, that will be Thursday evening at 7 o'clock, PBS Channel 18 is going to be a program called The Conversation. And Lorenzo Rios was the moderator, okay, of that program. That's where I first met him 2 weeks ago as they filmed that. And if you watch it, look at the audience as they pan the audience, because you'll see you'll see the Butterfield Clan, all right, sitting out in the audience. And Andy DeManuel is on one of the discussion panels. I'm on another one, and then there's a third one with current and retired military professionals. And I think it's going to be a really, really good program. So that will be on Thursday night, the 10th, at 7 p.m. I think I got that straight. So I hope you'll be engaged in as many of those activities as you possibly can this week. Let me highlight a few other things going on. Seniors Luncheon is on Election Day. So seniors, go vote. Come have lunch here. It's Turkey Day, all right? There's going to be turkey. There's going to be dressing. You're to bring a side dish and a dessert. Last week we had a hand of about 70 folks who are going to be here for the Seniors Luncheon on Tuesday. If you did not raise your hand last week because you weren't here or because you were unsure, but you know today you're going to be going, would you raise your hand? So we need to see if we need to add the number. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We got 7 more raising their hand. All right. So I got him. We're not going to forget him. All right. So good. We're probably going to have 80 then. And that'll be an exciting day around here. And if you don't vote before you come eat, on your way home you can go vote. Okay, we'll catch you one way or another. There's going to be coming up on Sunday evening, November the 20th. That's 2 weeks from today. A lot of our small groups will be wrapping up our study on spiritual simplicity. Hey, if you didn't do the study, or if you did do the study and all you bought was the question book, I want to encourage you. I want to motivate you. Go to Majesty and buy the actual book. The book is really, really good on spiritual simplicity. So we're going to have a little get-together. It's potluck. Going to kick off Thanksgiving week the way you should. We're going to eat. And so we'd love for you to come. Bring your small group. If you're not part of a small group, come anyway. Find out what small groups are all about. It's just going to be a night of sharing. And there's going to be some, I understand, pretty fine raffle prizes given away. All right? Some pretty fine raffle prizes. Fun times. All right. So that's going to be, what time does that start? 5:30? I can't see it. 5:30. Okay. 5:30. I got a sign-up sheet, but I should have two. Oh, there it is. Okay. So if you're going to be attending, this is from 8 o'clock service, they'd love for you to sign up and put down the favorite fall food that you will be bringing. And Tim and Shelley are going to be bringing chili verde soup. I signed us up this morning, babe. All right. And we're doing chili verde soup because when we've taken it places, they ask for it back. So that's a good sign, all right? Yeah, if they don't say, could you bring it again? Then we don't ever do it again. But this is what, and so we've got down chicken and lasagna and cookies and lemon bars and chips and salsa. Okay, so that's what we already have coming, and we're going to get more, all right? So sign up, let them know, so we'll be set up and plan for the folks who are going to be showing up. Let's see, Angel Tree, the outreach ministry that we do with Prison Fellowship for children at Christmas time. When a boy or a girl has an incarcerated mom or dad, or sometimes both parents incarcerated, Christmas is one of the hardest times for them. So we try to make a difference by giving a gift to that child in the name of their incarcerated parent and in the love of Jesus Christ. And so next week you'll have some Christmas trees up somewhere on the property, and there'll be angels on them, and you are going to come take an angel. It will have a name, an age, and information about that child. You will register that angel. Do not take it without registering it with the appropriate folks, and you will take it. Over the next 2 weeks, you'll have the opportunity to go buy a gift, $25 or less in value, have it wrapped, bring it back here, and then we have folks who will also deliver them to the children before Christmas time. It's a wonderful way for us to reach out. We've had members in our church who have followed up with Angel Tree Kids for 12, 13, 14 years, and it's an exciting opportunity for us to make a difference. So that will be next Sunday. Ladies, you've got your ornament exchange coming up on November the 28th. There's directions for you in there, so please take the opportunity to follow up on that. Yes? Stand up, please. Use your outside voice like you're talking to your husband.
I love you so much. Anyway, yes, so we did have a bulletin, but it starts at 6:30 that night. Tickets will be on sale next week in the Pavilion, and that has tickets for time. And also, I want to let you know, we are raffling off one of Emma and the Quilt Club's a Christmas quilt. And the proceeds are going to go to the Hernandezes.
To go
with that. And but it's $1 per ticket or $20 for your hike in tickets. And if you want, I'll let you use me.
Being tall is helpful. All right.
Or you can use me.
Woo! Atta boy. Yeah. I'll stand in for you. Yeah, I was always the last pick for the basketball team. Okay, let's move into some prayer requests. And I've got quite a few that are not listed in your bulletin. So let me take care of this. And Allison, this is going to be your opportunity to exit to my right. Yeah. You might go with her. Thank you, Shelly. Let me introduce, because I can do this standing here when we're not standing in cold water. We have a surprise baptism today. Okay? This is unannounced. This is a surprise. Some of you will recall, less than 2 months ago, I came back telling you about the fact that I did a memorial service in Bakersfield in a backyard, all right, with the family. And at the end of that service, all right, in the backyard, as I had my head bowed to pray, as soon as I said amen and I raised my head, Allison was standing right in front of me, right there, all right? I got to be honest, that doesn't happen very often at memorial services. And she's standing right there, and I looked up and I said, Allison, and she said, I want to find God. And I said, well, that's great, that's wonderful. And she said, I mean now. And I kind of said, here? And she said yes, and so we talked. I wanted to make sure that she understood what finding God was all about, and so we had a little Q&A, didn't we? And we talked through that, and then I said, do you still want to find him? And said, yes, I do. And right there in a backyard, all right, at her great-grandmother's memorial service, she invited Christ in her life. Out of death comes life, okay? God can take the worst moments sometimes of our life, and he brings something incredibly good out of it. Now, she went on to share with me that she was going to be leaving at an uncertain time in the future because she enlisted in the United States Air Force. Okay? She leaves at noon today for boot camp. And so I was able to stop by briefly yesterday at her open house, all right, to say goodbye. And as we were having some time to talk, she said, do you think maybe whenever it is that I get back that we could work out a baptism? I'd like to be baptized. I didn't know it was going to be this quick when I was leaving, and so I didn't get it done before. And I'm sitting there thinking, and she told me she's from boot camp, she's not coming home, she's going to tech school, and who knows what will happen after that. And I said, you know what, she might never get her way back to Clovis for a long time, and that would be a shame. I'd feel really bad, all right, that we didn't get this done. So she knows somebody who has a little bit of in at New Hope, and we said, we can pull this off tomorrow morning. And so that's what we're going to do after our offertory today. We're gonna have a baptism just for Allison today. Okay? All right. Go. She didn't have a big enough in, though, to get me up in the attic to make sure that the hot water heater was on. And so the water is cold. Okay? So I'm really glad it's just one. Just one. Okay. Now, prayer requests. Well, she's getting dressed. Tina Brown from our church, her cousin Dana in Southern California, was scheduled to have heart surgery at the end of the week, but her health condition was so bad that they were going to postpone it. So please be remembering to pray for Dana. Tammy Harris has a cousin whose name is Tim, and he had a fall and landed his head on the cement. And so he was unconscious, and then they put him in a induced coma, lowered the temperature of his body. Today or tomorrow, they're going to be raising that temperature. And so until they do that, we will not know what his situation or condition is. So please be praying for their family. This morning early, I got a text from Joe Avila. He and Mary are on their way to Visalia, to Cahuilla Delta Hospital. His sister, who for a couple of years has been battling breast cancer, she made the decision a few months ago to no longer fight it anymore. That was a losing situation for them, and it looks like her homegoing is very, very near. So Joe and Mary are with their family in Visalia. Fonda Bashir's Kilgore attends here on occasion. Her parents were part of Dad's church when I was just a boy in Fresno, and she has also been battling breast cancer since May. It was already at stage 4 when it was discovered. And so she is at Hines Hospice Home. And I saw her Friday, talked with the family yesterday. It's imminent, so please be remembering to pray. Debbie, wave. Debbie, you're back there. That's Debbie W, because I never can say the last name, all right? Yeah, that name. Most of you will recognize her husband Bob, all right? He's the guy who had long gray hair, sometimes wore knickers, all right? Short pants. Won the Bunko game night when we had Bunko here, all right? Beat all of us. He was discovered with Alzheimer's just a few months ago, had a very, very rapid decline. I saw him Friday from about 2 to 2:30, maybe 2:40, and I just found out this morning, about 10 minutes after I left, he met Jesus face to face. And so please be praying for Debbie and her family. We're so grateful that his suffering was not long and that he was comfortable. He was also under hospice care for these past couple of weeks. So then Marie Little, this is Janet Mattson's aunt, one of 12, and she's the last daughter in that group of 12, and there's only one younger brother left out of 12 siblings, and that service will be November the 19th. Continue to remember the Ashmore family. Christy's uncle's service is going to be this coming Saturday, and then the following Saturday is Marie Little, and then Darren Orr's service, Terry's nephew, was this last Friday. So continue to remember those families. And then Ron Cross, good friends of Teddy and Barry. Ron comes, hangs out in our Thursday men's group. His sister just passed away in Southern California. So if you'd remember Ron Cross and his family. Those are the updates. Would you join with me as we pray? And after we pray, our ushers are going to wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. So gentlemen or ladies, whoever you are, if you'd come forward, please. And right after our offertory, we're going to have our baptism. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for the life that you share with us. In a world that is chaotic and in times which are challenging, we never have to despair. We never have to be frustrated. And when we do become frustrated, when we do sense a bit of despair, if we remember to turn to your scriptures give us hope. Your scriptures give us strength. And the reason the scriptures give us hope and strength and peace is because the scriptures tell us about your Son, the Lord Jesus, the one who said, if we confess our sin, you are faithful and just to forgive us. You'll cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and you will never leave us nor forsake us. when we are reminded of your abiding presence in us, because at some point in our life we confessed our need for you because of sin, and you forgave us of our past, our present, and our future, and you've come to live within us. When we remember who you are and who we have become because of you, hope is restored, strength is renewed, peace is rekindled in our lives. And so thank you that even as we've given this litany list of very despairing situations, though we grieve today over Bob, we are not sad. We grieve because of his absence from his wife and his kids, but we rejoice in his presence with you. Fonda's moments are short on this earth, but Father, her hours are long in eternity. And so today, in the midst of those moments, we rejoice. Father, there's an election that some say is the worst potential election in the history of America. But guess what, Father? You're not surprised by this. And so we don't have to be surprised. We don't have to meet this unprepared. And so may we abide in you and let you abide in us and provide for us what we need at a time just like this. For the privilege of giving and sharing today, we say thank you. For the generosity that's been shown in so many ways in recent weeks, we give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. It's brisk. Real quick, Larry Bollinger, how's your sister?
She's doing good. She had to spend an extra day in the hospital, but she's at home now with her.
Okay, so if you would be remembering Larry's sister and also his brother-in-law, Carl, back east, both of them have had challenges, physical challenges this week, and we don't want to forget to remember them in prayer. Allison, come on down here and join me, please. Some of you might be visiting with us. You're saying, Tim, what is this thing you're doing? This is called baptism, all right? And most of you have heard about it. And very careful. A little chilly, isn't it?
No, not at all. Yeah.
Remember, it's going to be worse in the Air Force. Okay? I grew up in church. We used to sing a song, I'm in the Lord's Army, okay? And you're now in the Lord's Army, and you are in the U.S. Air Force, all right? And trust me, I've been in about 30 seconds longer than you. I don't feel it anymore, okay? My legs are numb, all right? It's good. This is exciting. It's great when you've had the privilege of kind of watching your grandparents grow in a faith relationship with Jesus Christ, and you get to see it take place in another generation. So this is great fun. She used to be a little girl who ran around here at Vacation Bible School, and sometimes at Sunday school, and you wonder, are they ever listening? Are they paying attention? She had been. What happened on that day at your great grandmother's service? That was just the harvest of lots of days of planting and watering and you being prayed for. And you came to that decision all on your own without pressure. And I'm excited for you. As you head into the Air Force, I want you to remember you really are in God's army. God can use you in that place of military activity to be a force for Him. I gave you those two books yesterday for a reason. So I'm going to be quizzing you on them when you get back, okay?
Okay.
Because those are things that will help you grow in your faith in such a way. So, Allison, a couple of pertinent facts for them. How old are you? 18 years old. Okay, 18. Where'd you go to high school?
Buchanan.
Buchanan Bear. All right. God bless you. God bless you. And did you invite Jesus Christ in your life?
Yes.
Did you confess the fact that you were a sinner and you were in need of a Savior?
Yes.
And you know now that not because of how you may have felt that day or this day, but because of what the Scripture says is true, that Jesus now lives in your heart.
Yes.
And you know that wherever you go, though you're going to be a long ways from your parents and your grandparents and from your favorite pastor, you know that Jesus Christ will always be with you every moment of every day.
Yes.
Okay. Then let's do this today.
Okay.
All right? Turn to face Shelley. All right. Step up closer. Step up. Just like this. Allison, because you invited the Lord Jesus Christ to come live within your life, because you recognized without Him you were lost, and with Him you've never been more found than you possibly could be, because you love Him, because He first loved you, it is now my privilege to baptize you as my sister into God's family. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
What you saw did not make Allison a Christian. She already was before she stepped into these waters. What you saw was a physical, visible illustration of what it means when you say, Lord, I want to die to myself because I realize I'm a sinner. And so putting you under the water is a picture of being buried and then coming up out of the water, which is what they did to Jesus on Good Friday. And coming up out of the water is a picture of resurrection morning. It's a picture of her new life in Jesus Christ. So what we did is we made a birth announcement to our entire church family that she has been born again.
Allison, did you find your way back in? Okay, all right, good. Was the water cold? Yeah. You're going to make a great, great part of the U.S. Air Force. Just so you remember this day, all right, certificate of baptism to Allison Williams, November 6, 2016, followed Christ in the obedient observance of baptism at New Hope Church. God bless you, my dear. I know we're running a little behind time, but who cares? Okay, this is good stuff today, and I want to do something else. We're blessed to have Chris Bishop's dad in service with us today. So I would like to ask a favor. I would like for you to come join me in the center aisle, if you would, for just a moment. Chris also has his coach, all right, that works with him, and former boss, I understand, with him today. We've prayed for Chris's dad several times over the last several months. As you know, he's had heart challenges, fell and actually kind of banged your head after one of those events. And you're scheduled for, we haven't got the date yet, but a pretty major heart surgery, okay? So we want to pray for you today, if you don't mind us doing that. He's a brother pastor, all right? So we kind of have to help look out for each other. And so would you join with me as we pray for him and God's best in these next several weeks? Our Father, I love you so much. I thank you for the way in which, on occasions, you provide generations of ministry in a family. And you have certainly done that in the Bishop family, from father to son, the love of Christ, the carrying of the torch of truth. And I am so grateful for this man, because without this man, his son would not be here as our youth pastor. And so we're grateful. We trust you with his needs over these next few weeks as he pays attention to the doctor's wisdom and direction, and they're doing their best they can to bring him to good health. But Father, where human efforts fall short, your wisdom does not. And so we pray for your best. And if it is a great healing of his physical heart, then we say amen before it ever occurs. And God, if that is not your best in this situation, then we know you will provide strength and peace and hope and patience in the process. We pray for his wife as she is there beside him for everything. Give her the uncanny strength that you would have in store. We trust you for all this. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Bless you, my brother. Best to you.
Thank you.
All right. All right. And he's one of those pastors that I've learned to hate in my lifetime. He can sing and play the piano, all right, as well as preach, all right? So one of those multi-talented guys that I've always envied, all right? Invite you to turn your Bibles, if you would, to Psalm 136, all right? Psalm 136. You probably today, because of time, I'm going to go really, really fast, so put your tennis runners on your ears, okay? And we're going to get after it today. Psalm 136, and I want to read verses. I would love to read the whole chapter, but for today, we're going to read verses 1 through 9. As you know, we've been in the book of Psalms all year, except for last month. We took a break and did our Make a Differences messages, and so today we're going to step back into it. Since November is Thanksgiving, Psalm 136 is a great way for us to step back into the Psalms as we celebrate the theme of gratitude for this entire month. In your Bibles, in this chapter, does it have the first part of a sentence in regular letters and then the second half of the sentence or the verse in italics? So here's the way we're going to do this today for the first 9 verses. I'm going to read the first line. You all in unison are going to read the second line. Okay? You have a tough job. I think it's the same sentence all 9 times. Okay? I think you can handle this today, though. Here we go. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Give thanks to the God of gods. Okay, don't get weak on me. Stay bold here, okay? Stay bold. I think we sing this song quite regularly, don't we? His love endures forever, all right? Here we go, verse 3. Give thanks to the Lord of Lords. Yeah. To him who alone does great wonders. Who by his understanding made the heavens. Who spread out the earth upon the waters. Who made the great lights. The sun to govern the day. And the moon and the stars to govern the night. And we'll stop right there. This is a testimony to our gratitude to the God of creation. The next several verses deal with the gratitude we should have towards a God who redeems and rescues as they remember what God did for Israel when they were in Egyptian captivity and brought them out, took them all the way through the wilderness, and eventually brought them to the place of promise. What a description of us who today are Christians, and what a description it could be of you if you have not yet made that decision that Allison made just a few weeks ago, that you could be delivered from the enslavement and the control of sin in your life, and you can be redeemed and rescued and have freedom from that and know Jesus Christ in an intimate personal relationship. Being a Christian is not about being religious. It's not about being a member of a church or an organization. Being a Christian is having a relationship with Jesus Christ. Nothing more, nothing less, nothing else. Go read the book of Colossians. It'll prove that to you. Today we're going to look at the subject of gratitude, thanksgiving. And I'm afraid it's a lost art in our society today. I just listened to a program this week on KMJ, and I'm not sure why they were on the subject. Maybe because it's Thanksgiving month. But one of the ladies called in and she said, let me tell you what we've lost the art of. Written thank you notes. I don't mean printed ones. I mean written, handwritten thank you notes. And it was this long conversation about that. And it reminded me of, really, quite frankly, we don't think to say thank you near often enough. We don't often say thank you enough to God until we're in trouble. And that's when we turn to him. Reminds me of two men who were walking through a field when a bull got angry and spotted them. Instantly, these two men dashed for the nearest fence. The raging bull followed in hot pursuit. It was soon apparent they weren't going to make the fence. Terrified, one shouted the other one, put up a prayer, John, we're in for it. John said, I can't, I've never prayed out loud in my life. But you must, the bull's catching up to us. All right, said John, I'll say the only prayer I know, the one my father used to repeat at the dinner table. Oh Lord, for what we are about to receive, we are truly thankful. You see, it helps to pray in the good times as well as the troubled times so that you're ready for the troubled times and you know better how to pray. Thankfulness does seem to be this lost art. Warren Wiersbe illustrated the challenge in his commentary on the book of Colossians. He told about a ministerial student in Evanston, Illinois, who was part of a life-saving squad. In 1860, a ship went aground on the shore of Lake Michigan near Evanston, and Edward Spencer waded again and again and again into the frigid waters to rescue 17 passengers. In the process, he got very ill, and his health was damaged permanently. Some years later, which came earlier than expected because of the rescue that he had been engaged in, it was noted not one of the 17 people whose life he saved ever thanked him. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have everlasting life. That is what God and his Son did for the world, and I wonder how many really, truly thank him. When we think about Thanksgiving, what's the first thing that pops in our mind? Turkey, food, yeah, I'm an 8 o'clock service, they were all over this. Food was said in unison in the 8 o'clock crowd, all right? Yeah, we tend to think about food, the great feast that we're going to have. And I want you to understand, in the expression of our gratitude to God, we need to remember that part of what we're grateful for is the great feast that he has provided for us. And the next passage I'm going to look at, I'm going to be honest, it's a little gory. If we don't understand it in its proper setting, we kind of scratch our head and we say, wow, that's kind of tough to swallow. Excuse the pun. But in John's gospel, it talks about this great feast that satisfies us in a way that nothing else can. John chapter 6, verses 50 through 58, read like this. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. Unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and you drink his blood, you have no life in you. Now, I want you to understand, this is not cannibalism. What God is doing is he's taking a physical image and he's trying to help us understand a spiritual truth. And just as you think about eating when you think about Thanksgiving, God wants us also to be grateful for that which God has provided that nourishes our life. So this is a physical example to demonstrate a spiritual truth. Let me illustrate another occasion when Jesus did this. Do you remember one afternoon when Jesus left his disciples and he walked into town and he went to a well in the middle of the day? Now, Jesus didn't go there because he was thirsty. Jesus went there for a spiritual encounter. Jesus went there for a divine appointment. He knew there was a woman who was going to come out in the middle of a day, a very peculiar time for women to go get water at a well, usually first thing in the morning or last thing early in the evening. And Jesus went there for one woman because she was thirsty in a way she had no idea how to satisfy. She shows up with her pitcher and her bucket to draw water, and Jesus said, hey, would you like to know about water where you would never have to dip out of a well again? She said, I'd love to know that. And so he talks about a relationship with him. You see, Jesus told her, he said, ma'am, you've been married four times, and the man you're living with, you're not married to now. You are thirsting, looking for an answer in your life, and you're looking for love in all the wrong places. I am going to give you water. Jesus talking about himself. I am the living water. Springs of rushing water will flow in you and you will never thirst again. So you with me on the picture? This is really, it's an allegory. The picture of one thing in the image of another. And so he says, without eating my flesh and drinking my blood, there's no life in you. Unless you've appropriated my sacrifice for you, there is no forgiveness of your sin. There will be no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh, drinks my blood, has eternal life. I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is real food. My blood is real drink. Whoever eats and drinks remains in me and I in him. Just as I, the living Father, sent me. And I live because of the Father. So the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread. Okay, just change the analogy from flesh and drink. Now he talks about bread. I'm the bread who came down from heaven. Your forefather others ate manna and died, but he who feeds on me, the one who is the bread of life, you will live forever. We talk about great feasts and we talk about Thanksgiving. There's a lot of planning into a feast. It doesn't just happen. You got to plan. And so this great feast of the life of Jesus Christ made available to us was made with careful preparation. Well, this wasn't something that Jesus thought of the last second. This wasn't kind of like our baptism today. Okay? We spent a lot of time planning this one yesterday. Okay? And God honored that, I think. But here's the deal. In the feast that God provided for us, God, the scripture says, before the foundation of the world, before I ever created man and woman, I already had a plan to get them out of the mess they'd end up in. See, he already made careful preparations. He even sent John the Baptist as a forerunner to tell the world that the feast is coming. It goes all the way back, if you want to Genesis chapter 3. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you've done this. What was this the serpent had done? He had tempted Adam and Eve to eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And so God said to the snake, which was actually Satan, cursed are you above all the livestock. And all the wild animals, you will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. Ladies, how many of you like snakes? Yeah, ladies. Yeah. Okay, I got one, all right? Most women don't like snakes, all right? Why? Because God said they wouldn't. It goes all the way back to the garden. This is where the problem originated from. There'll be enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He, Christ, will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. You see, on the day of crucifixion, Satan thought he had destroyed the plan of God. The day Jesus died, Satan threw the most grand party in hell you could ever imagine. They were celebrating like fools, all right? And they were fools. Because you see, on Easter Sunday morning, the party came down with a crash. The hangover was horrible. And on that day, the head of the serpent was destroyed. Satan is finished. He just doesn't know it yet. He'll know it when Jesus Christ comes again. 30 years ago, the boy's great-grandfather, Red Adams, lived in Dustin Acres outside of Taft. He was an oilman. He was a mountain man. He was a horseman. His hands, his fingers were gigantic. The first time I shook hands with him, I had to go look for my hand. It just lost inside of his. Powerful, powerful man, strong man. And his sons, the boy's uncles, told, and I actually had the privilege of watching him do it one day, there are snakes in Taft, okay? And so he was not afraid of them. He would get a stick, and he would take a coiled-up rattlesnake, and he would stretch it out. And with that stick, he would play with its head so it was distracted, and he would reach down with his other hand, and he would pick up that rattlesnake by its tail. And he would go once, twice, and then he would go boom, and he would literally pop the head of that snake off of its body. Strong, strong hands, man. And then he would drop that snake down, and do you know what that snake's body would do? It would just move through the dirt. It would coil up. You see, it didn't know it was dead. It thought it was still alive, all right? It took a while for it to get the message. It's taken a while for Satan to get the message. He is finished. He will know. Everything will start functioning the day that Jesus Christ comes again. We don't preach this a whole lot much anymore because people kind of get creeped out about Jesus coming again. Folks, he is coming again. I don't know if it will be in our lifetime or our kids' lifetime or the great-grandkids. The church has been expecting it ever since the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They keep thinking he's coming. He is coming. He is waiting for grace to do its best work in the entire world, and he will come again. Just a side note. And the scripture says, the dead in Christ will rise first, and they will see him. I haven't got all this figured out. Some Bible writers have this thing figured out. I don't. As much as I've read it, I don't have all the details figured out. Here's the big picture. The moment I die, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Boom, just like that. God takes me through the valley of the shadows and he brings me into the light of his glorious home called heaven. That's where my spirit and my soul are, all right? And we're going to be with him. I don't know what I look like as spirit and soul. Are you with me? This is what I have to look at every single day, all right? I avoid mirrors. But I don't know what I'm going to look like. The Bible said God is spirit, and those who worship him, spirit and in truth. I don't know what that looks like. And I, quite frankly, I don't have to. I don't need to have that figured out. I just know when this body dies, I'm not dead. I'm alive forevermore, and I'll be with him. So what that tells me is at the moment that Christ comes again, the Bible says there'll be the reuniting of my soul and spirit, which has been in heaven, back with this new body that God has raised from the dead, just as Jesus Christ's body was raised from the dead. For 3 days, Jesus' spirit and soul were in the place called the Hadean world. And then on Sunday morning, that spirit soul of Jesus was back in his body, raised from the dead, and he could pop up in a room and have lunch with his buddies. Okay? And so I don't know, but on that day, when spirit and soul come back to my resurrected body that comes up, the scripture says, I will see him coming from where? The east. He's coming from the east. Just a side note, have you all ever paid any attention to how 95% of the cemeteries in America are laid out? Have you ever noticed? Have you ever paid attention? You're buried this way. Your head there, your headstone there, so that when your body is raised, you are looking east. Why? So that I can see him with my physical eyes. I will have seen him with spiritual eyes, but I will see him with these baby, they're not baby blues. I will see him with these brown eyes, all right, at the moment I am raised from the dead. And this is what Christ has done for us, and we will know then ultimate victory, and Satan will know final defeat. So this is not only made with careful preparation, but it's also made with costly dedication. It is told that in the First World War, there was a French soldier, a young man, seriously wounded. His arm so badly smashed, it had to be amputated above the elbow. He was a magnificent specimen of young manhood, and the surgeon was grieved that he would go through life maimed. So he waited at the bedside to tell the young man the bad news personally. When the lad's eyes opened, the surgeon said to him, "I am sorry to tell you that you have lost your arm." And the young man said, "Sir, I did not lose it. I gave it for France." Jesus Christ did not lose his life for you and me. Jesus Christ gave his life for you and me. He gave his life so that an Allison Williams can go into the U.S. Air Force and not be afraid of anything that might happen to her. Jesus gave his life for her and for you. Jesus was not helplessly caught in this mesh of circumstances. He could have called 10,000 angels at any time, but he didn't lose his life. He willingly gave it. The cross was not thrust upon him. He accepted it, and he did it for us. It's also met with complete satisfaction. It's made with careful preparation. It's made with costly dedication, and this incredible feast brings complete satisfaction. I have never left a family Thanksgiving dinner disappointed. Have you? Not once, man. I always go away full. When we remember completely what Christ did at the cross for us, we will never leave the cross disappointed. I had a sing in the 8 o'clock service. I forgot to tell Tim about this, and that's okay. We didn't have time anyway. There's an old hymn I grew up singing in church. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now, man, I'm happy all the day. At the cross, my sins are forgiven, my debt was paid, my new life began, and I am completely satisfied. Not only do we eat a great feast, but we enter a gathering of the family. We share now a family ancestry. His story becomes my story. We share a family album together. Every one of us are pictures of grace on God's refrigerator door. And as I look at my own family, I realize, boy, did God give incredible grace. My Grandpa McLean, he was a womanizer and a lush. My grandfather, George McLean, he was. He'd been married 3 times before he met my grandmother in his late 20s. He was around her. My grandmother knew Jesus. My grandmother told my grandfather, "You ever come to this house drunk, you'll sleep on the porch." He didn't believe her. He slept on the porch. And a few days later, he went to an old-fashioned Brush Arbor meeting out in the sticks of Oklahoma. I heard a preacher talk about being completely satisfied in what Jesus Christ could do at a cross for you. And my grandfather repented of his sins. He changed his wicked ways. He never had another drop of alcohol again. He was married to my grandmother until the day he died. He started over 30 churches between Oklahoma and California. He is a picture of grace on God's refrigerator door. My dad is a family picture of grace. My dad ought not to be here. I was reminded of that as I listened to veterans talk last night. My dad, at 19 years old in World War II at the Battle of Remagen, worked his way across the street, volunteered to go rescue one of his buddies, and ended up shot in the middle of the road. Guys were able to get him on the hood of a Jeep along with another guy, and they went across the bridge. It's amazing he didn't die in the street. They got him on a Jeep, drove across the bridge over the river. Yeah, the Rhine. All I could think of was the River Kwai. I was thinking of a movie. The Rhine River got them across, and as soon as they got across the river, one of those guys driving the Jeep said to the two guys on the front end of it, "Some God must be looking after you." They just blew the bridge up. My dad probably ought not to be here, and he's 91 years old. And you know what? If he wasn't here, you'd have a different pastor today. Some of you say, "Wow, that's something to think about." And my dad was right with God, and God used my dad to start 5 churches in the state of California. God's trophies of grace. We also share a family anticipation. We have got brothers and sisters all around this world. I've had the privilege for the last 5 years of getting acquainted with some of them in the Ivory Coast of Africa. And it's exciting to know that from every tribe, kindred, race, we are going to be part of God's family. And we can anticipate getting to meet them and spend an eternity with them. And let me wrap this up. We will also not only do we eat a great feast. And not only do we enter a gathering of a family, but we end all of this with a grateful feeling. Deuteronomy 8:10 says, when you've eaten and are satisfied, when you have shared and partaken in the life of Christ, you will be satisfied. Praise the Lord your God for the good land that he has given you. We should be grateful for the gifts he's given. Are we? Oh, we're grateful when we first get saved, but the longer we're a Christian, do we stay on our knees in gratitude? Do we write 26 verses to a prayer that says, give thanks, give thanks, give thanks. Your love endures forever. William Moses Tidwell tells of a woman in charge of an institution that was giving loaves of bread to poor children who would gather at the appointed time every day. As soon as the door was opened, there would be a mad rush, and all the children except one little girl would try to grab the biggest loaf that they could find, and then they would run off. After they were gone, that one little girl would come up, pick up the loaf that was left, that the rest of them had left behind. She would walk up to the woman who had provided the bread, and she would quietly and politely say, thank you. After watching this for several days, the woman made one loaf, only about half the size of all the rest of them, but inside of it, she placed a gold coin. The next day, as usual, the rest of the children took all of the big loaves and left the smallest one for the last little girl. She took it. She thanked the woman as usual without one word of complaint or frustration. When she got home and gave it to her mother, who was a believer in Christ but was bedbound, when the mother cut the loaf and found the gold coin inside, she made her daughter take the gold coin back to the woman where she got the bread. When the girl returned with the assurance from the woman that this gold coin was hers and her mother's to keep, the two of them bowed their heads and thanked God who wonderfully, miraculously provides. Do you see God's gold coin in the midst of your small, tiny loaves? Sometimes we're so busy looking at the size of the loaf that we miss the gifts that he has for us in troubled moments. A farmer went to eat out in a restaurant in town. It was his custom to always bow his head before he ate, even in a restaurant. At the next table, there were some rowdy young men who began to poke fun at the old farmer, and they said, hey, farmer, that's out of vogue. Nobody does that anymore. The farmer said, yeah, I know. I've even got some members of my own household who won't pray before their meals either. Hey, you got smarter relatives than you. Who are they? The farmer answered dryly, they're my pigs. I wonder how many members of God's family, all right, might not be as thankful as we potentially should be. We should be grateful for the group that is gathered. Seagulls, they look beautiful in the air at the ocean, don't they? A guy by the name of Jonathan Livingston Seagull, remember that book that came out, all right? It was all about the individuality and the ruggedness of seagulls. Seagulls don't play well together. I understand one man did a test. It seems gruesome. He tied a red ribbon around a seagull's ankle. It made all the other seagulls mad because they wanted what he had, and they literally pecked him to death. They don't play well together. Unlike geese, wild geese, we see them around here all the time. They fly in a V shape, in a uniform. There's a reason for that. God put into them this instinct to do that. Why? Because it's beneficial for the flock. It's not the strongest one who leads the pack. They rotate every few minutes, okay, so that one in front, because he's facing all the resistance. And then at the back, the two back corners are for the weakest and for the youngest. And do you wonder why geese honk so much? It's to encourage those who are in the back to stay up with the rest of them. You see, they work together as a group. God has called his children to work together. We're not called a flock. We're called the church. We're called his family. And God wants us to be grateful for the group who gathers together. And last of all, we should be grateful for the good giver. Sir Walter Raleigh was continuously submitting requests to Queen Elizabeth on behalf of convicts in prison. Once the queen said to him, Sir Walter, when will you stop being a beggar? And his reply was, when your majesty ceases to be a giver. The Lord Jesus will never cease to be a giver to the needs that we have and that we face in this world. He has an inexhaustible source of blessing in our lives. With this, I'll close. When Billy Graham was driving through a small southern town, he was stopped by a policeman. much as I confessed to last week. He did not see grace at the moment I did. He was charged with speeding. Graham admitted his guilt, but he was told by the officer, "You're still going to have to appear before the judge." The judge asked him, "Guilty or not guilty?" Graham pleaded guilty, and the judge replied, "Mr. Graham, that'll be $10, a dollar for every mile you went over the limit." Boy, would I wish we had those fees again. Suddenly, the judge recognized the famous preacher. He said, "Mr. Graham, you have violated the law, and the fine must be paid, but I'm going to pay it for you." And he took $10 out of his own wallet, attached it to the ticket, and then he took Billy Graham out and he bought him a steak dinner. "That," said Billy Graham, "is how God treats repentant sinners." God would love to treat you that way if you've never accepted him before, if you've put him off, if you're not assured that your home is in heaven, if you didn't realize that Satan has already been defeated, then why postpone 1 minute longer to invite Jesus Christ to come live within your life? Using your own words at this very moment, say, "Lord Jesus, I want to be a repentant sinner who experiences your grace in their life." Would you join with me as we pray? Father, I want to thank you for the life that you share with us. Thank you for the opportunity of being part of your family. Thank you for the joy today of sharing with Allison in this very special moment, and we pray for a future. Lord, I trust you with each of our needs today, and for that man or woman, that young person who maybe at this moment is saying, "Lord, I didn't come here to become a Christian, but I can't leave here without being one. Would you come live within my life?" Thank you for hearing confessions for many of us as your children who have not demonstrated a grateful heart as the writer of Psalm 136 has, praising you for a love that endures forever. Father, we pray for the Sheriff's Department here in Fresno. They have been hit with such challenges over this past week, and particularly for the family whose husband was shot and killed this week. His memorial service is this Wednesday. He was one who loved you. And so thank you that in his absence from us, we have confidence that he's with you. And I pray that your presence will be evident in the lives of his family, and that in the midst of this very, very disheartening moment, they will experience your encouragement. We trust you for all of this. In the incredible name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.